Morning, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, everybody. Welcome to week 10 of our focus program on analytic function spaces. We start with lectures by Emmanuel Fricane from Université de Lille. He's gonna talk about TTO. Lecture one, Emmanuel, please.
Thank you. So let me thank first the organizer and particularly Shavad for this nice semester at Fields Institute. Shavad said, my lecture will be devoted to fascinating classes of operators, so the so-called truncated duplets operator or TTO. So we had already had a mini course on model spaces by Stéphane, and last week Bill talked about tuplets operator on RD spaces, and in fact we can say that in a sense the theory of truncated tuplets operator is a mix between these two subjects, because in fact, as we will see, truncated tuplets operator as a compression of tuplets operator to model spaces. But at the first sight, TTO seems to be close to tuplets operator. In fact, we will see there are a lot of difference between these two classes. And in fact, my lecture will be in fact devoted to sort of parallel between these two classes. So this class of operators has been formally introduced by Donald Savasson in 2007. Though some special cases have long ago appeared in the literature, most notably as a model operator for completely non-unitary contraction and for their commutants. So this new area of research is now very active, and many open questions posed by Savasson in 2007 have now been solved, but nevertheless there are still basic and interesting questions which remain mysterious, and I invite young people in the audience to interest in this beautiful subject. So first, let me recall some basic notation and definition. So as usual, I will denote D, the open unit disk of the complex plane, and T will be its boundary, so the united cycle. And as usual, H2 will be H2 of the unit disk, so the RD space, which consists of space of analytic function, whose Taylor coefficients are square summable. And in fact, as usual, we will also identify this space of analytic function via radial limit as the closed subspace of function in L2 of T, whose negative Fourier coefficient vanish. So let me maybe recall that H2 is what is called the reproducing kernel Hilbert space. So it means more precisely that if you consider this function, which is the Cauchy kernel, where lambda is in the unit disk. So if you make the scalar product of a function f in H2 with this function k lambda, then you recover the function, the value of the function at lambda. And so the scalar product is given, for instance, by the scalar product in L2 of T. And I will also use the space H infinity, which is exactly the algebra of analytic and bounded function on D. Now, I will recall some basic facts on tuplets operator on H2. So for a function phi in L2 of T, I define the tuplets operator T phi f as the so you take your function f, you multiply by phi, and then you project on H2. So P plus here is the orthogonal projection from L2 onto H2. And so here, since phi is in L2, you obtain just a densely defined operator. So it's well defined on, for function f in H infinity. And in fact, it extends boundedly on H2 if and only if the symbol phi is in L infinity. So this is a result due to Braun and Almos, who in fact built the foundation of the Wolf theory of Toeplitz operator in their famous paper in 1963. And in fact, when phi is in L infinity, you can also compute exactly the norm of T phi. This is equal to the L infinity norm of phi. And the adjoint of T phi is just the Toeplitz operator with symbol phi bar. So all these things were well explained by Bill last week. So it's just some reminding. And now I will just give two important examples for us. So the shift operator, which corresponds to the symbol Z. And it's in fact here in that case, you get it's just the multiplication by Z, in fact. And its adjoint is what is called the backward shift operator. And as I explained here, you get the Toeplitz operator with symbol Z bar. And you can see easily that it's also expresses using this formula. And in fact, these two operators play a central role in operator theory and analytic function space theory. Okay, so now I will also need the notion of inner function. So let me recall that function theta is called an inner function if theta is in H infinity, which I recall U means that theta is bounded and analytic on the unit disk, and its radial limits, which exist almost everywhere, are of modulus one, almost everywhere on T. And so I recall you that every inner function theta can be factorized in two parts, in fact. The first part is what is called a Blaschke product. So this is an infinite product, which contain, in fact, all the zeros of theta. So here you can easily see that this infinite product vanishes on the sequence lambda k. And so that this infinite product converge, you need, in fact, that what is called the Blaschke condition, which meaning that this series is convergent. And the second part of theta is what is called a singular inner function, and which exactly means that your function S mu can be expressed in terms of this integral, where mu here is a positive finite Borel measure on T, which is singular with respect to the Lebesgue measure. So sometimes we will use this factorization. So this is why I recall it. Okay, so now let me go to model spaces. So given an inner function theta, we can associate what is called the model spaces K theta, which is defined as a complement, the orthogonal complement of theta H2 in H2. So it means that you take all functions in H2, which are orthogonal to theta G, where G runs over H2. And in fact, it's quite easy to see that it's also equal to the intersection of H2 with theta Z bar H2 bar. So maybe I can just explain why. This is just an easy fact, because if phi is in, saying that phi is, f is in k theta, sorry, it means that phi f is in H2, and theta bar f is orthogonal to H2 using this, because theta is of modulus one almost everywhere on T. And so it means that it's equivalent to say that f is in H2 and theta bar f belongs to z bar h2 bar. And then using one more time that theta is of modulus one on the united cycle, you get that f is in h2 and f is in this is in theta z bar h2 bar. So in fact, this definition will be important when we will need to generalize k theta in a Banach space setting. So k theta is called the model space. We will see in a moment why. But let me note that, of course, you can easily see that theta h2 is invariant with respect to the shift operator. So if you apply the shift operator to theta h2, you will be in theta h2. And so this implies that the orthogonal complement of theta h2 will be invariant with respect to the adjoint. And in fact, Berling, in a famous paper, proved the converse in some sense, so which means that every closed subspace of H2, which are invariant with respect to the backward shift operator, to the operator A star, are of the form K theta, where theta is some inner function. So this model spaces, in fact, describe all the lattice of invariant subspace of A star. Okay, now I can give the definition of our main object, so the truncated Toeplitz operator. So given an inner function theta and a function phi in L2, the truncated Toeplitz operator, or TTO, is denoted by A phi or A phi theta, if we want to infer on the space where it acts. So it's a densely defined operator whose domain contains, in fact, k theta intersect h infinity. And on this space, it acts with the following formula. So you take your function f, you multiply by phi, and you project on k theta. So here, p theta is the orthogonal projection from L2 onto k theta. And of course, if you want, you can put here the projection on H2, and you get that it's also equal to P theta T phi F. Okay, so I said that it's a densely defined operator because, in fact, it's easy to see that K theta intersect with H infinity is dense in K theta, because it contains all the reproducing kernel k lambda theta of k theta, which are given by this formula. And in fact, this formula, of course, are in k theta, because they are, in fact, they are reproducing kernel of k theta. And in fact, they are also in H infinity because it's easy to see that the denominator is bounded away from zero. And so K lambda theta belongs to H infinity. And of course, they span a dense set in K theta because if you have a function F in K theta, which is orthogonal to all reproducing kernels, of course, it will be identically zero. And so this space is dense. And so you get a densely defined operator. And in fact, I will be interested in this operator, which extends, in fact, boundedly on k theta. And I will denote this space as tau theta. So tau theta will be the truncated Toeplitz operator, which can be extended boundedly on k theta. Okay, so now let me give some simple examples. So the first example is when you assume that your symbol phi belongs to L infinity. Then in that case, it's easy to see that phi f will be in L2 for all f in k theta. And so when you look at p theta phi f, of course, since p theta is an orthogonal projection, you can bound it, these terms with the L2 norm of phi f. And since f is in L infinity, this is bounded by the L infinity norm of phi times the L2 norm of f. And so it exactly means that A phi is bounded on k theta. So you get a bounded operator on k theta, and its norm is less or equal to the norm of phi infinity. But be careful, contrary to the case of Toeplitz operator. So I remind you that for Toeplitz operator, the norm of T phi is exactly equal to the L infinity norm of the symbol. Here, we will see that it's not true in general. You just have this, in fact, inequality. And in fact, you can get some example where the norm of f a phi will be zero. In fact, the operator will be zero, even in with a symbol phi not zero. So you can have a strict inequality here. So the second example I would like to give is when phi is equal to z. So this is just a particular case of first example. And here the Toeplitz operator, the truncated Toeplitz operator associated to this symbol, we will denote it by S theta. And it is called the model operator on K theta. We will see in a moment why, but it's a very important operator. It will plays a special role in the theory. So another simple example is the example related to Toeplitz matrices. So let me start with this simple inner function. So theta z is zn, so it's of course an inner function. Sorry. And so in that case, k theta, it's easy to see that it corresponds exactly to the set of polynomials of degree less or equal to n minus one. And now if I start, so it's in particular a finite space, finite dimensional space. So now if I start with a function phi in L2, and I looked at this scalar product, A phi zj against zk. So I rewrite the definition of A phi. Here, I can suppress the orthogonal projection on k theta because zk is in k theta, is already in k theta. Because k is less or equal to n minus one. And then I put that terms here. And so I get the scalar product with phi against zk minus g, which is exactly, in fact, the Fourier coefficient of phi, the k minus g nth coefficient, Fourier coefficient of phi. And in particular, you see that if you look at right at the matrix A phi with respect to this orthonormal basis, you get exactly a Toeplitz matrices, right? So it's constant against this diagonal. And so the matrix representation of A phi with respect to this orthonormal basis, one, Zn minus one, is a Toeplitz matrix. And conversely, it's easy to see that any n by n tuplets matrix, in fact, gives rise to a truncated tuplets operator on KZn. So in some sense, truncated tuplets operator can be viewed as a generalization of tuplets matrices. Okay, so this is some nice example. And now I will go on with some basic remarks. So the first remark I would like to say is the following. So if you have a function phi in L2, which gives rise to a bounded truncated tuplets operator A5, then in fact, its adjoint will be also a truncated tuplets operator. And the symbol of this truncated tuplets operator A5 is the truncated tuplets operator with symbol phi bar. So maybe I can just explain the proof because it's very easy. So you start with two functions f and g in k theta intersect with h infinity. And you look at the scalar product with f between f and a phi star g. So of course, by definition, it's a phi f g. And so it's an orthogonal projection on k theta of phi f against g. And since g is in k theta, you can remove the orthogonal projection here on k theta, and it's phi f g, which is also equal to f phi bar g. And here you can put again the orthogonal projection on k theta, and it gives you exactly that this function is equal to this function. And so it gives you exactly, because of course here it's f a phi bar g. Okay, so so the adjoint of a bounded TTO is itself a TTO. So maybe let me focus on another example. So when phi is in L infinity, is in H infinity, sorry, so analytic and bounded. So as I said, for the shift, but it's also true for any tuplets operator with analytic symbol, theta H2 is invariant with respect to T phi, because here in that case, since phi is analytic, T phi is just the multiplication by phi. So theta H2 is invariant with respect to T phi, and so it's a general principle. Its orthogonal project complement, K theta, will be invariant with respect to the adjoint of T phi. And we have seen that the adjoint of T phi is T phi bar. And so it means that the adjoint of a truncated tuplets operator A5 with symbol phi in H infinity is just the restriction of T phi bar on K theta. So you don't need to put the orthogonal projection on K theta, because if you start with a function f in K theta, T phi bar f will still be in K theta. So no need to put the orthogonal projection on K theta in that case. And in particular, so I remind you that the S theta is just a z. And so the adjoint of this model operator S theta is just the restriction of the backward shift operator on K theta. Okay. So another easy fact to notice is that in fact the space of bounded truncated triplets operator in fact forms a linear space. This is because it's some algebraic simple computation. In fact, you can easily check that if you start with alpha, beta, two complex number, and phi and psi in L2, and you look at alpha a phi plus beta a psi, then it's equal to A with symbol alpha phi plus beta psi. So it's exactly said that it's a linear space, but be careful, it's not an algebra in general. In fact, what you have is, maybe I can just add this, in that case where the symbol is in H infinity, or the two symbols are in H infinity, then it will be an algebra, in fact. In that case, you have this, in fact. But this is more or less your, not, this is not true, but this is a simple case where you have this. But in general, the product of two truncated triplets operator is not a truncated triplets operator. In fact, Sarasson, in his paper in 2007, gives this simple example, not so simple to prove, but there are some argument and computation, but at least it's a rank two operator defined by this formula. And if you start with an inner function such that its associate model space has dimension greater than 3, then you can prove that this operator is a truncated triplets operator. But if you look at its square, it will be not a truncated triplets operator. Okay, so it's an exercise, but not so easy, in fact. So, but the details are in the paper of Sarasson. So I let the detail. Okay. So in fact, one of the main difficulty, but also in fact the richness of the theory is the fact that in fact in the theory of TTO, the symbol of a TTO is in general not unique. And this is what, in a sense, the main reason why the theory of TTO differs so much from the theory of triplets operator. Because, okay, for triplets operator, the symbol is unique, but for TTO, this is not the case. And I can explain at least one direction, explain why this is the case. So, if you start with a symbol phi in L2 and you consider two functions phi psi 1 and psi 2 in H2, then if I take a function f in k theta intersect with H infinity, it sees, so the truncated triplets operator with this symbol applied to f is exactly this. So I just write the definition. And now observe that this function theta psi 1 f is in fact is theta h2, because psi 1 is in h2, f is in h infinity. So this product psi 1 f is in h2, and so this will be in theta h2. And so when I project onto k theta, which is the orthogonal complement of theta h2 in h2, I will get zero. Okay. And now using the second equivalent definition of k theta, I can also see that this part will be in z bar h2 bar. And so the projection of this function on k theta will also give zero. And so in fact, you get exactly that this function is, you can forget these terms because they give zero, and you just obtain that it's equal to p theta phi f, and it's, which says exactly that it's a phi f. And so in other words, it means that these two truncated operators are the same. And so you see that you have a lot of liberty of symbol, because you can add, you can take any function psi 1 and psi 2, and it will give you the same truncated Toeplitz operator. And in fact, Sarasson proves in some sense the converse, and he identified exactly the class of symbol for a given TTO. And more precisely, he proves that given an inner function theta and a symbol phi in L2, then the truncated Toeplitz operator A phi is identically zero if and only if the symbol phi is in that space theta H2 plus theta H2 bar. And so consequently, two truncated Toeplitz operator A phi 1 and A phi 2 will coincide if and only if the difference of their symbols are in that space. So I prove one direction, and for the other direction, I refer to the paper of Sarasson. So we see that given a TTO, we have the class of possible symbol is huge. But nevertheless, Sarasson also proves that there is a canonical way of writing the symbols of a TTO, which then gives some unicity. And more precisely, he gets the following corollary. So given a phi in L2, then there exists a pair of functions phi one and phi two in case theta, such that the truncated Toeplitz operator A phi is equal to A phi one plus phi bar. And in fact, if you fix the value of phi 1 or phi 2 at zero gene, then this representation would be unique. So for instance, you can assume that phi 1 or phi 2 would be zero at zero origin. And then you get a unique representation with conditions that phi 1 and phi 2 are in case theta. And for instance, phi 2 of zero is zero. Okay. So maybe let me give an example of such a presentation. So I come back to Toeplitz matrices. So I start with the Toeplitz matrices A of three by three matrices. And I recall you that when theta z is three, then k theta will be the polynomial of degree less or equal to two. Then if you consider this symbol phi, ez bar square to the power two plus dz bar plus a plus bz plus cz to the power two, then in fact, it's easy to see that in that case, A phi coincide with as this representation in the orthogonal basis 1, z, z, z2. And in fact, you can it's easy to see that, of course, you can decompose phi as psi plus psi bar, where phi and psi are in k theta and defined like this. So it's polynomials of degree less or equal to 2, so they are in k theta. And the sum of these two functions exactly give you phi. Okay, so maybe now an important question. Of course, we may wonder why studying TTO. So one reason is because it's fun, but maybe it's not very serious reason, at least if you want to convince someone in not in the in the area, but okay, there are some maybe more serious reasons. So the first reason is, as I said, it can be viewed as a generalization of Toeplitz matrices. So this is the first reason. Second reason, in fact, they appear in model theory of Nag-Fourier. So now I will explain a little bit why the operator S theta we already meet and which appears as a particular case of a truncated Toeplitz operator, why it is called the model operator. So in fact, Nag and Fourier prove the following beautiful theorem, saying that if you start with an Hilbert space contraction T, so contraction from H to H, where H is some Hilbert space, and you assume three things. The first thing, you assume that T star N converges to zero for the strong operator topology. And second thing, you assume that what is called, so you assume that these two operators, identity minus T star T and identity minus T star, are of rank one. Then you can prove that there exists an inner function theta such that T is unitarily equivalent to S theta. So in some sense, S theta can serve as a model for a large class of Hilbert space contraction. And okay, the advantage of this is, okay, an Hilbert space contraction is can be very difficult object, but S theta, okay, is a more simple operator. But okay, the problem, life is not easy. I mean, the problem, of course, is not the operator, but rather the space. In fact, because K theta has a difficult structure, and in fact, okay, you gain something. From the point of view of operator theory, but there are still some difficulties. Okay. Nice theorem, and I mean using this model operator and this model theory of Nag-Fourier, you can get a lot of in fact result, interesting result. Okay. And so maybe I will try now to explain you maybe an other reason of studying TTO, which comes in fact from also an interesting problem concerning this some interpolation problem based on the commutant of S theta. So this approach to this interpolation problem was discovered by Savasson a long time ago now. In fact, let me mention in fact that it's very easy. In fact, it's a consequence of what I said before. So if you have a symbol phi in H infinity, it's easy to see that it's commute with the model operator S theta. So F A phi S theta is equal to S theta A phi. But be careful, it's true because phi is in H infinity. If it's not analytic, then it would be not true in general. So you have this commutation relation. And in fact, what Savasson proves is that the converse is true. So if you have a bounded operator on K theta A, and if you assume that it's commute with S theta, then it will be of the form A phi for a symbol for a function phi in H infinity. And also you can recover the norm of A as infimum of the H infinity norm of phi for all taking the infimum on the class of all symbol in H infinity. And this infimum is in fact attained. So you can find a function phi in H infinity such that you will have exactly the equality between the norm of A and the H infinity norm of phi. So this is what is called now the commutant lifting theorem. And I will just explain you as it can serve to solve a classical problem in interpolation theory, so the Nevan-Linapik interpolation problem. So I recall you that the Nevan-Linapik interpolation problem is the following. So you start with n distinct points in D, lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda n, and n value omega 1, omega 2, omega n in C. And the question or the problem is the following. Can you find a function f in H infinity which interpolate the data? So such that for any k in between 1 and n, f lambda k is equal to omega k with a control of the norm. So for instance, you impose that the H infinity norm would be less or equal to 1. Of course, if you forget this control, the problem is very easy. You can interpolate with even a polynomial, but the problem is that you want also to control the norm by one. And in fact, what Nevan-Lina and Pick proved is that this problem has a solution if and only if the matrix, this matrix Q, is non-negative. Okay, so I will explain you a little bit the proof and how the truncated Toeplitz operator are involved in that problem. So the first basic observation is the following. So if you have a function phi in H infinity, in fact, the Cauchy kernel K lambda are eigenvectors for T phi bar for the adjoint of T phi. So you have this formula. If you have attended to the lecture of Dan on De Bruijn-Chouinard spaces, he uses a lot this nice formula. So now I will introduce the finite Blaschke product associated to the n point on D, lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda n. And in that case, the associated model space KB is just generated by the Cauchy kernel K lambda 1, K lambda 2, K lambda n. I will introduce also the operator R on KB just on the basis, in fact. So asking that R K lambda I is equal to omega I bar K lambda I. So I take, in fact, the diagonal operator with respect to this basis, where the value on the diagonal are given by this value omega 1 bar, omega 2 bar, omega n bar. And I remind you that the adjoint of model operator SB is just the restriction of TZ bar or restriction of the back redshift operator on KB. And now using 2, we see that RSB star applied to K lambda I is just lambda I bar R chi lambda I. And using the definition of R, you get this one. And of course, you can reverse the computation, and you get that it's also equal to SB star R K lambda I. And since K lambda I generates the model of space KB, in fact, you deduce this formula. So R commute with SB star. And now using the commutant lifting theorem, in fact, it means that this R is exactly the adjoint of some truncated Toeplitz operator, of the adjoint of some truncated Toeplitz operator with a symbol phi in H infinity. So in fact, R is A phi bar for some phi in H infinity. And in fact, as I said in the theorem of Sarasson, you can also obtain the norm of the operator which commute with SB star or SB. And you can find a function symbol phi such that its H infinity norm will give you exactly the norm of R. So first observe that, of course, if you look at omega I bar k lambda I, it's R chi lambda I. So it's A phi bar k lambda I. And since in that case, phi is in H infinity, this is just the restriction of T phi bar to KB. And using one more time the same formula, it will give you phi lambda I bar k lambda I. And so you see that you have solved the interpolation problem. So you find a function phi in H infinity such that phi lambda I is equal to omega I for any I between 1 and n. And the only problem is the constraints on the norm. And now there is an easy computation, and we give let the details, saying that if you look at I minus R star R against applied to this function against the same, you get exactly, in fact, the action of the matrix which appears in the theorem against the sequence A1, A2, AN, scalar product with the same. And in fact, it says exactly that these matrices will be non-negative if and only if this operator would be non-negative. And this is equivalent, of course, to say that the operator R is a contraction. And of course, since phi is chosen so that the H infinity norm of phi is equal to the operator norm of R, it gives you exactly that the H infinity norm is less or equal to one. It is equivalent to say that matrix Q is non-negative, and you are done. So this gives you, this explains the role, in fact, of a particular case of truncated Toeplitz operator in this interpolation problem. And of course, there are some other examples where this approach using commutant lifting theorem is useful in to solve some other interpolation problem. Okay, so I hope I convince you that truncated Toeplitz operator are worth studying, and I hope that you will come back to the other lecture tomorrow and in 2 days. And in fact, in this two next lecture, I will study some more concrete properties of truncated Toeplitz operator. For instance, we will study when this truncated Toeplitz operator are finite, some result on the spectrum, and so on and so on. And I just stopped with some references where you can find what I discuss and many more properties. So concerning Toeplitz, classical Toeplitz operator, so I invite you, of course, to look at the paper of Bohn and Almos, who, as I said, built the whole theory of Toeplitz operator. As an introduction on truncated triplets operator. So there is the paper of Sarason who really built the whole theory of this beautiful class of operator. And you can find also a nice introduction in sorry, I didn't find the term in English. A survey, sorry. In this beautiful survey of Garcia and Ross, and also there is in the book of Garcia and Ross devoted to the model operator, there is a nice chapter devoted to TTO. And so you can find a lot of results in that direction. So I thank you for your attention.
Thank you indeed. Thank you. Just wonderful, wonderful talk. Any question or comment for Emmanuel? Marco asked a question in the chat. Do you see the chat, Emmanuel?
Yeah. Okay. So is more or less explicit. In fact, the inner function. In fact, okay. First, let me maybe say that in fact you can have a more general result. In fact, I just here put a version of their result, but in fact you can get a result for getting, in fact, this condition that the rank are rank one, but then you have to deal with, in fact, a version of model space which are vector valued, and it's more difficult. But in fact, yeah, there are a sort of explicit formula for theta. And in fact, theta is what is called the characteristic function of contraction T. So there is a formula, but of course, it's not completely easy to if you give me a contraction, I cannot promise you that I can compute explicitly the function theta. In some case, you can. For instance, I think Bill give us an example where you can get a formula for in the context of Volterra operator. I think there are some operator where you can have some explicit computation, but
By the way, I'm not going to take a credit for what Manu just mentioned. It's actually Sarason did that. He explicitly, but yeah.
Okay. You mean the example you provided?
Yeah, well, the one where you could have the Volterra operator and you could show that you can compute theta and things like that. Sarason actually did that. I mean.
Sure. Any further questions or comments? If not, let's thank Emmanuel again.